Good afternoon, students. Welcome to the live lecture of Real Analysis 2. In the last lecture, we have seen some important theorems regarding the bounded and convergence. That is, the first theorem we have seen is bounded convergence theorem. What is this theorem is telling us? Whenever we have a sequence of bounded functions, mod of fn of x less than or equals to means the functions are bounded. So whenever we have a sequence of bounded measurable functions such that this sequence is converging to a function f, say, then we wanted to prove that integration f over e is equals to limit of integration fn over e. The proof we have discussed in detail. Second, we have seen how to calculate the Lebesgue integration of a non-negative measurable function. Previously, we have calculated the Lebesgue integration of bounded measurable function, but now it is non-negative measurable function defined on a measurable set p. For here we were finding actually integration by finding one function, one bounded measurable function h such that h is less than or equals to f, and then by taking suprema of all such h functions, right? And this is what we were defining to be a Lebesgue integration of any non-negative measurable function. And this is what the one theorem we have seen regarding the operations of integration of these non-negative measurable functions. The first one is integration CF is C times integration F. Integration F plus G is integration F plus integration G. Whenever F is less than or equals to G almost everywhere, then integration F is less than or equals to integration G. The detailed proof we have seen, I am not going to the proof again. The next we have seen is a Fatou's lemma. Pierre-Joseph-Louis Fatou was a great French mathematician. He has given a theorem regarding fn be a sequence of non-negative measurable functions such that fn converges to f almost everywhere on the set E, then it is asked us to prove that integration f is less than or equals to limit infimum integration fn. Okay, then as this statement is less than or equals to, therefore this is somewhat a weak statement. Okay, whenever we have an equality, it will be said to be a strong statement. Therefore now, our next theorem which we were going to see is giving us an additional requirement or additional condition to be imposed on the sequence of functions so that equality is going to hold. Here is the note. The conclusion of the Fatou's lemma is weak. It asserts only integration f is less equal by limit infinity. In order to get equality, we should have more conditions on the sequence fn. Therefore, the next theorem is actually a monotone convergence theorem, which is a stronger form of Fatou's lemma, in which the condition is given that integration f is limit integration fn. But the sequences under the consideration are increasing sequence of non-negative measurable function. That of in Fatou's lemma, we have only sequence of non-negative measurable functions. Which condition is added now? Fn be a sequence of
increasing sequence
of non-negative measurable function. Therefore, what we wanted to prove for such a sequence fn to be the which is actually increasing sequence of non-negative measurable functions, and f is equals to limit fn almost everywhere. What is the meaning? The sequence fn converges to a function f almost everywhere. I think you are perfectly knowing the meaning of almost everywhere. Wherever this condition is, right, measure of the set must be zero, right? Then what is asked to prove? Integration f is limit fn, limit integration fn. This is what we wanted to prove. But when we say that the limit exists, whenever both the limits are same, no? That is, limit inferior is equal to limit superior. And only we say that the limit of the given sequence exists. Now here, Fatou's lemma tells us about one part of the inequality, that f is less equal by limit inferior. F is less equal by limit inferior. That is what we have written by statement number 1. Since fn be a sequence of non-negative measurable functions, can we apply Fatou's lemma? Because Fatou's lemma is true for any non-negative measurable sequence. Right? Now here, the Fatou's lemma is applicable, which tells us that integration f is less than or equals to limit inferior integration f. Now this point we will use as this given sequence to be an increasing sequence and fn converges to f almost everywhere. Therefore, can we write fn is less than or equals to f? because the sequence is increasing, no? Whatever is f1 of x we were getting is less equal by f2 of x, less equal by f3 of x, and so on. What is f of x? What is f? F is its limit point. But obviously one can say that fn is less than or equals to f for all n in n. If fn is less than or equals to f, what about the relation between their integrations? We have seen it, no? It's equal, right? F less than or equals to g almost everywhere tells that integration f less than or equals to integration g. We have seen this already, right? No? Right? So this is what we have already. If arbitrary every for every n, if integration fn is less than or equals to f, what about its supremum value for every n if I consider? For n equal to 1, this is integration f1 less than or equals to integration f1. Yeah, therefore here we have taken the supremum. As every arbitrary value of the set is less than or equals to integration f. That is, integration f works as an upper bound for the elements integration fn for all n. Right, no? This works as an upper bound. Okay. And what for suprema? Suprema is least upper bound, no? What is the relation between least upper bound and upper bound? Least upper bound is less equal by an upper bound, right? For this relation holds for suprema as well. Suprema for n greater equal by k, integration fn. For all k in n, no doubt. Okay. Now what about infima? If I am taking suprema, I have taken over n. Now I will take infima over k. What will be infima? What is this role of k? Are you getting? If I take k equals to 1, this will be n greater than or equals to 1. If I take k equals to 2, here it is n greater equal by 2 and so on. Right? No. And every suprema is less equal by integration f. Therefore, if I take the infima value of the corresponding set over k, may I say it is still less equal by integration f?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Because infima is actually a greatest lower bound, and greatest lower bound is always less equal by an arbitrary upper bound. That is also another point one can. What is infimum of supremum integration fn? Here we know the definition of limit supremum. What is limit supremum of fn? This is infimum of supremum of fk. Here what we have obtained, no? If whatever is this term we have obtained is nothing but limit supremum, limit superior is less than or equals to integration fn. Now let me call this as statement number 2. Here we have written, what is 1 we have written by Fatou's lemma? Integration f is less equal by limit superior, limit inferior. But here we have obtained limit superior is less equal by integration f. And what is the obvious relation between these two, limit inferior and limit superior? Here it is. Limit inferior is less equal by limit superior. Now check out the inequality. Integration f less equal by limit inferior, less equal by limit superior, less equal by integration f. These two are equal. Therefore, may I say the limits are also equal?
Yes, ma'am.
Of this type, na? A less equal by B, less equal by C, less equal by A. Right, no? If you take one by one, this is A less equal by B, B less equal by A. Whether it gives A is equal to B? Yes.
Yes, ma'am.
Take the, this C one. A less than or equals to C, less than or equals to A. Whether it gives you A equal to C? Yes. Therefore, A equal to B, A equal to C will give you A equal to B equal to C. That is what we have written here. Integration f is equal to limit inferior equal to limit superior. And whenever these two limits are same, we say limit exists. Therefore, we have written limit integration f. Hence, the proof holds. If you have any difficulty, you can ask me. By using Fatou's lemma, we have written this statement number 1. And by knowing the fact that the sequence is an increasing sequence, we have proved that limit superior integration fn is less than or equals to integration f. And hence, equality holds. And as limit inferior, limit superior are equal, we can say integration f is equal to limit integration f. Correct? This is what? Monotone convergence theorem is. Previous one is Fatou's lemma. Right? Next, we will go for one nice corollary depending on this monotone convergence theorem. Corollary says that let u and v be the sequence of non-negative measurable functions and f to be a function defined as summation un n runs from 1 to infinity, then prove that integration f is summation integration un. That is, if I take the integration on both the sides, integration summation un it will be, no? Now we wanted to prove it as summation of integration un. That is, summation and integrations are interchangeable. That is what we wanted to claim. Now, as I wanted to prove this as a corollary of my previous monotone convergence theorem, in monotone convergence theorem, we need a sequence of increasing non-negative measurable functions. Okay, so we'll try to construct increasing sequence by using this un. Okay, therefore, what is un? Non-negative measurable functions. F is defined to be summation un n runs from 1 to infinity. Now we will define a sequence of functions fn by a finite sum of these uk's. Here f is given to be an infinite sum of ui's, no? But now I'll take this to be finite sum. That is, fn will be a sum uk where k runs from 1 to n. So what will be my f1? Is it u1 only?
Yes, ma'am.
For u2, summation k runs from 1 to
u2.
Yes, it is u1 plus u2. What ui's are? Non-negative measurable functions. Right? And just we will continue like this, no? So what about the sequence f1 we will form? Ui's are non-negative. Therefore, the sums are also non-negative. Therefore, may I say this fi's or fn will form a sequence of increasing sequence of non-negative measurable functions, right now?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so this will be increasing sequence of non-negative. Here I have read, here the statement was written. Since uk's are non-negative measurable functions, fn's are non-negative measurable, and it will form a increasing sequence of non-negative measurable functions. Okay, what is the second job? How to construct this f then? F is summation n runs from summation un n runs from 1 to infinity. Therefore, if I put a limit here, n tends to infinity, whether it constructs f or not?
Yes, ma'am, I do.
What is f? May I say this is limit n tends to infinity fn? Put a limit n tends to infinity here. It will give you f. This is what we have here we have written. What is the meaning of f is limit n tends to infinity fn? May I say fn converges to f? The meaning of this is fn converges to f. What is f? Summation. The parameter was changed. Summation n, summation un n from 1 to infinity. One can write as summation uk k runs from 1 to infinity. Is that okay? Now let us apply monotone convergence theorem. Now, as this fn we have constructed to be increasing non-negative measurable functions sequence, therefore we can apply monotone convergence theorem to write integration f is limit integration fn. Integration f is limit integration fn. Now, what is limit integration fn? Fn we know. This is summation k runs from 1 to n uk. Okay. Let me just run up the sum. Let me just run up the sum. What this sum gives us? U1 to un. Okay. But for finite sums, we have already proved, no? Integration f plus g is integration f plus integration g. Right now? So can I separate the integrations over ui separately?
Yes, ma'am.
So for now, let us separate and let us try to write this as a sum. Now, this is actually sum of integration uk's. Sum of integration. Now, you check. The order has changed. Right now? Integration of summation. Now, we have written summation of integration uk's. And this is for finite sum we have proved. We have proved this for finite sum. Now, let us put a limit. What will be a limiting value then? Limit n tends to infinity will give us summation k runs from 1 to infinity summation, integration uk. Right now? What we have proved, integration f is summation k from 1 to infinity integration uk. But what is integration here? What is here? What is here? This is given. Then what is integration f? Just take integration on both the sides. Integration f is integration of summation, no?
Yes, ma'am.
Therefore, we have proved. That's the proof. Therefore, this is a corollary. Actually, tells us that we can interchange this role of summation and integration for infinite terms also. We have proved it previously for finite sums. Now we have proved it for infinite terms of the integrations as well. This is what I'm meaning, no? Integration of summation is equal to summation of the respective integrations. And here the upper limit is infinity. Therefore, this is true for the infinite number of terms as well. Right? Any difficulty in the corollary?
No, ma'am.
Next. Now we will prove the next proposition regarding separating the integration defined on the given domain. How? Let us check. Here f is given to be a non-negative measurable function and set ei, sequence ei be the disjoint sequence of measurable sets and e is union ei, union run over I. Okay, then our aim is to prove integration over f, integration of f over e. What is integration f over e actually? This is integration union ei, no? Integration over union eis, right? That is, this is actually integration over e1 union e2 union so on, en union so on. Directors. Up to, this is arbitrary union, right? Okay. But for finite, we have proved already integration F over A union B. Somewhere we have proved, no?
Yes, ma'am.
But this is for finite union, no? This we have proved, na? Integration over A plus integration over B. Where we have
yes,
proved?
Ma'am.
Let us just check where we have proved.
Bounded measurable functions say subpoints madhe.
Yes. Here it is. No. Let me just show you where we have it. Here it is. Integration f over a union b is integration f over a plus integration f over b. But what we have proved, this is only for finite, na? Finite union a union b for two. If it is true for the union of two sets, one can say that it is true for finite union as well. But now we wanted to prove this for infinite union, no? Arbitrary union it is. Right, no? Now, what we have proved this to be integration F plus integration. Therefore, may I write this as summation integration F. Right, no? For two terms only. Now
yes,
we wanted to prove the same thing regarding arbitrary union of the domain. This is E is the domain, no? Instead of domain, I see the set on which integration is defined. Right? Now we wanted to prove this as summation of respective integrations here defined over EI and then a sum is taken. This is, it's a case like this. First, you take the separate integration on every set and then take the summation. We have proved it for finite union. Now, our job is to prove it for the arbitrary union. Okay, let us try to prove. First, we were trying to define one function, say ui, which is defined to be f into characteristic, chi of ei. What is chi of ei actually, chi ei? Chi ei is having a value 1 if your term belongs to ei and if not it is 0, right? Now this is the characteristic function value, right? Therefore, whenever your element x is in e1, what is the value? This is x e1, no? and the corresponding function will be f into 1, and that we were going to call as f itself but defined over e1. Now we were defining f separately on every set e1, e2, u up to en, and the new function we were calling as ey. F into chi ei gives us the value of a function on every set ei. Is it okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Now, let me try to find out what is value f into chi of e. What is e actually? E is union ei. What is the value of chi union ei? Chi of a union b we have proved, no? Chi of a plus chi of
if
b.
If they are disjoint.
Yeah, disjoint. And not here it is given here be a disjoint sequence of measurables. It is given already. If a chi union ei can be written as chi e1, chi e2 and so on, which is summation chi ei. But here this is f into summation chi ei. Summation runs over I. But this term f is independent of I. Therefore, one can include it in the sum as well. Therefore, this is summation over I f into chi ei. But chi ei we have given a new name called as ui. Therefore, what is f into chi e? This is summation ui. New function ui. Is it understood? Ui, we were defining the new function. F into chi ei. Whenever we put the particular value of I, this will give a function defined on the respective set only. That is, if I put I equals to 2, this u2 will be f into chi e2. Chi e2 is a value 1 if element is a member of e2. If not, it is 0. Therefore, f into chi e2 will take a value f only if x is in e2. Therefore, what will be u2 then? U2 is f, but for the elements of e2 only. Are you getting me?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Therefore, this ui, hear this statement. Ui is f only, but for elements of ei, correct, no? This new function is f, but specifically defined on the corresponding set. Therefore, we have proved f into chi e is summation ui. Therefore, what is the corollary we have proved just now? Integration f is this, no? Summation integration u kids. Therefore, let me just use this corollary. Integration f is integration chi e, but integration chi e is summation ui arbitrary. Therefore, let me just change. How can I change this? Integration summation I have interchanged, no? Actually, integration f into chi e is integration f, integration of summation ui. Okay, and by using the corollary we have written summation of integrations. We have interchanged the position summation and integration. That is interchanging role of summation and integration, right? By using this corollary, I have changed the rule. And therefore, integration f becomes summation over I integration ui's. But what is ui's we have defined? F into chi ei's. Therefore, what is integration f? Just wait. Right? Therefore, here it is actually integration f over e. We summation integration f into chi ei. But what is f into chi ei integration? F into chi ei is f, but defined on ei. Here I have written no. Ui, ui means f into chi ei. Why the page is changing? Ui, what is ui? F into chi ei is f only, but it is defined for the elements of ei. Therefore, this f into chi ei I am writing as integration f, but defined over ei. Right? If we have proved summation over I integration ei. Integration f over ei. Yes, hence the proof, if you have any difficulty, you can answer. All the proofs you have to recall.
Yes, ma'am.
Very simple. If you understand this UI, no, then it is easy for you to understand the next part. How this UI works. UI is nothing but F only, but defined differently for the functions of, for the sets EI. Okay. Now, we will give an example here that the monotone convergence theorem is not true for the decreasing sequence of functions. Let us just see the statement of monotone convergence. This is the monotone convergence theorem, no? Integration F is limit integration F. We approved it for increasing non-negative measurable functions. Now we will produce one example that this is not true for decreasing sequence of functions, right? To check this for the decreasing sequence of function, it is sufficient for us to produce one counterexample. And the counterexample here we have produced, let fn be the sequence of functions defined by, how the sequence's function is defined, fn of x is equal to 0 for all x less than 1 and equal to 1 for x greater equal by 1. What is f1 of x then? Yes, what is f1? If I put the value of n as 1, say, f1 of x is 0 for all x less than 1 and is 1 for all x less than or equal to 1, right? Let me write one more. What is f2 of x? Is 0 for x less than 2 and is 1 for x greater equal by 2. Let us try to draw the corresponding graphs. F1 we will draw with a clear line. F2 we will draw with a dotted line. If what is this function f1? X value 0 for all x less than 1. For all x less than 1 means here I will take a red line. Before 1, right? Before 1 the value is 0. And for, here I have written less equal again. Here it is greater equal, no? Sorry. No. Okay. F1 I am showing with the red line, okay? Now, for x greater equal by 1, F1 takes one value. That is from this point and onwards, F1 takes a value 1, right? No? Now, let me define F2. What F2 of x is? F2 of x is 0 for x less than 2. Now, I will take a green line, see. Now this is 0 till 2, okay, and for greater equal by 2, it takes a value 1, that is from this point, right? Now, if I take f3, it will be 0 up to 3 and 1 after 3. If I take f4, it will be 4, 0 up to 4 and 1 after 4. What kind of sequence you are getting? Increasing or decreasing?
Decreasing.
Decreasing sequence, right? Therefore, here whatever this Fn is a decreasing sequence. How we can say decreasing? You may compare the value of F1 and F2 at 1.5. One may compare the value F1 and F2 at 1.5. What is F1 of 1.5?
1.
And what is F2 of 1.5?
0.
0. What is the relation? F1 of 1.5?
Greater than F2.
Right? Therefore, F2 is smaller at this point 1.5 by F1. Therefore, this gives you decreasing sequence, right? Now, from 2 onwards, they match, values are going to match, right? But before that, F1 is bigger. Then F2 is bigger than F3, up to 3, and so on. Therefore, Fn gives you the decreasing sequence, right? Therefore, this is a decreasing sequence. Now, what about their integration? What about the limit point? fn converges to function 0 may I say? Because this will be, what about f100? f100 takes a value 0 up to x less than 100. And 1 after x greater after 100, right? No. Therefore, if you go on increasing the value of your n tends to infinity, this whatever underlined n, if this n I am tending to infinity, what kind of function I am getting?
0.
0. Therefore, what is the limit function for this sequence? 0 function. Fn converges to f, which is nothing but a 0 function, right? Therefore, here integration f over r is a 0 function. Now let us check integration fn. Let us check integration fn. And we wanted to check whether this limit of integration fn is equal to integration f or not by monotone convergence theorem. Now what is fn? Fn, how we have defined? It takes a value 1 from n onwards. Right now? Fn takes 1. Fn takes value 1 from n onwards, right? N onwards means which interval I can say? Closed n to open infinity?
Yes, ma'am.
Value of fn is 1 on closed n to open infinity and rest 0. Rest 0. Therefore, can I define the function fn as chi of which interval? Closed n to open. Right now? Because what this chi function do a job? It gives you a value 1 for this interval and 0 for the complement. It's the element which are not in this interval, right? No. Therefore, this function fn is defined with the characteristic function. Therefore, integration fn is chi of closed n to open infinity. But we know what is integration chi a?
Major value of it.
Major of it. Therefore, what is this major? Major of closed n to open infinity. But what is, this is an interval, no? If what is the measure of this interval? Length
of infinity.
What is the length of this infinite interval? Infinity.
Infinity.
If what is the value we have obtained? Integration fn is infinity. Let us take limit n tends to infinity on both the sides. What is the value? Limit n tends to infinity. Integration fn is infinity. Let me call this as 1 and let me call this as 2. Whether 1 and 2 are same? No, they are not same. Therefore, monotone convergence theorem is not true for the decreasing sequence of functions. Right? Any difficulty in this example?
No, ma'am.
Good. Now, one more example is given that in the Fatou's lemma, we may have a strict inequality. The example is you have produced, you just go through the example. I'll skip to a next definition. Definition, up to now we have used the word Lebesgue integrable for a non-negative measurable function, right? Then, for a non-negative measurable function, whenever we say that it is integrable, whenever we say that it is integrable, then the value of integration must be less than infinity. For Riemann integration also we were saying the same, no? The function is said to be Riemann integrable or integration exists if integration value is less than infinity. Right?
Yes,
the same kind of conclusion we were carrying, that a non-negative measurable function is said to be integrable over a measurable set if the integration value is less than infinity. Now let us prove an important proposition. Given that f and g are two non-negative measurable functions, if f is integrable over e and g less than f on e, then g is also integrable. According to this definition, may I say this is obviously true? Check no. If g is
yes,
less
ma'am.
Than f, what about integration g and integration f?
Less
integration, then integration. If integration less than infinity, what about integration g? Less than infinity.
Less than infinity.
Right? Okay. We wanted to prove again that integration f minus g is integration f minus integration g on a measurable set E. Let us try to prove. To prove this, f and g be non-negative measurable functions. G less than f on E, that is f minus g greater equal by 0. Now f I am writing as f minus g plus g. For addition we have proved a result, no? Whether we have proved a result for subtraction also?
No, ma'am.
No. We have proved for subtraction for bounded measurable functions, I think, right? We have proved the result of subtraction for bounded measurable function, not for arbitrary measurable function. Now we were proving the result for any non-negative measurable function. Now integration f plus g is integration f plus integration g we have proved already. Therefore, separating this integration, this is integration f minus integration g. But what about integration f? As it is integrable, it is less than infinity. Therefore, g less than f gives you integration g less than integration f, which is less than infinity. Hence, integration g less than infinity gives you integration g is integrable. Therefore, what about this statement? Let us just shift this term on the left. What will be that shifting gives me? Integration f minus integration g equal to integration f minus g. Is it okay?
Yes, ma'am.
Any difficulty up to this?
No, ma'am.
Okay, now let us see one more preposition. Okay, therefore, what this preposition is regarding the subtraction of any integration of subtraction of any two non-negative measurable functions. Now we will prove a preposition. If f is a non-negative function which is integrable defined on E, then for every epsilon there exists a delta such that for every subset, for every set A subset of E whose measure less than delta, we have integration f over A is less than epsilon. That is, for every epsilon, we can have a subset A of the set E whose measure is less than delta and integration value is less than epsilon. Right? Suppose epsilon value is given to us some 0.5. Then our aim is to find a subset A of the set E such that whose major is less than delta and integration is less than epsilon 0.5. That is, however small the integration we want, we can find it, but we have to restrict the subset A of the set E whose major is less than delta, and for every epsilon there exists such a delta. That is what we wanted to prove. For every epsilon such a delta exists, such that for every subset A of E major of the set is less than delta and integration f is less than epsilon. Okay, we will divide the proof into two parts. We will divide the proof into two parts. Which two parts? First part, I will write it for non-negative bounded function. Whether boundedness given here? No. It is only non-negative function which is integrable. Boundedness is not given. Therefore, we will discuss two cases, for bounded and for not bounded as well. Right? For the first case, we will discuss. If f is non-negative and bounded, if it is bounded, can I find out one non-negative real number or positive real number m such that mod fx is less than m?
Yes, ma'am.
Suprema also holds. Actually, we were writing mod of f of x is less than m for all x in the set, which set? E, no? If mod fx less than m, what about supremum? Strictly less than by m again, right?
Yes, ma'am.
because this m works as an upper bound of the set mod fx for all x in E. Okay, and we know supremum is least upper bound, therefore the relation holds least upper bound is less than or equal to upper bound, right? Now this is least upper bound and this is arbitrary upper bound. Okay, now for every given it's longer than 0, we were going to choose delta. Why this is less than by this term we will discuss, such that for any set A with major less than delta, we get integration of f over A. What is integration of f over A? F less than m we have, no? Mod fx less than m we have. Therefore, may I say this is replaced by m? Function is non-negative. Yes, therefore, this is less than m. Integration m constant, integration over A. How this is being calculated? M I can take it out. This is integration of 1 over A. How this is being calculated? Integration, this is major of A, no?
Yes, ma'am.
M into major of A. Now, I want this M into major of A less than epsilon. M into major of A less than epsilon, provided major of A is less than delta. Therefore, what value of delta should I select so that this will be less than epsilon? M into delta less than epsilon. M into delta less than epsilon. Therefore, what should be delta? Less than epsilon upon m. Therefore, for this, for every epsilon, select delta less than epsilon upon capital M, where capital M is the bound for the function. Okay, therefore, finally, it will be less than epsilon. Right, no? Hence, the proof holds. But the proof we have done by using this concept. By using this concept, less than m. Because the function we have assumed is bounded. Therefore, the result is true for non-negative bounded function. Now, next consider f is not bounded. F is not bounded. Now, if it is not bounded, we will construct a sequence of, by using the given function, sequence of, increasing sequence of bounded function. Now, it's a challenging job to construct a increasing sequence of bounded measurable function by using a function which is not bounded. And this was done very nicely with this definition. See, the definition is, we will define a sequence fn by fn of x is f of x for if f of x is less than or equal to n and equal to n if f of x is greater than n. Sequences of non-negative functions, right? Non-negative means the function is not going to take any negative value, right? No? Let me try to explain how this fn is defined. Okay? First, let me write for f1. What will be f1 x? Is it f of x? If f of x takes a value less than or equals to n, and is n, n means 1, no? Now, here also 1. If f of x less than 1 and is 1, if f of x is greater than 1. Okay? What f is? Any function, not bounded function it is, but having a value non-negative. Means it starts with 0 and it may be, it is not bounded above, right? Now, whether it is bounded below, whether function is bounded below f function. Yes, students, what is f given to be? Non-negative. Non-negative it is given, no? If whether
yes, ma'am.
It is bounded below or not?
Yes, ma'am.
Bounded below by 0?
Yes, ma'am.
Like this, no? We have non-negative. If the function is bounded below, we know. Now, if I am considering it is not bounded, what does it mean? It is not bounded above.
Above.
Right? Now, let me draw a function f1. Function f is not bounded above. Therefore, let me just draw a sketch like this. See. Now this is going as well forward. This is my F set. Okay? This is my F. Now we were defining F1. What is F1 I have defined? F1 is equal to F for all the values of f of x less than or equals to 1. These are the values less than, say it is 1, say. This is 1. The function value is less than or equals to means which part? This part, no?
Yes, ma'am.
Function value lies between 0 to 1. Right? This is equal to f, means this part is same. But if the function value exceeds 1, what we have defined it to be?
1.
1. So let me just draw a constant line here, right? Therefore, this is my f1. Getting me? F equals to f1 for the function values lies between 0 to 1, means for this range. And if we go above 1, the function takes a value 1. Therefore, may I say, now the function f1 is restricted between 0 and 1. The function f1 is greater equal by 0, no doubt. And now we have said it is less equal by 1. Right now? Less equal or strictly less, I can write. Strictly less by 1, no? No, equal to 1. It takes a value 1 if f x greater than 1. Right? Therefore, how this f1 is being defined, understood?
Yes, ma'am.
How f2 is defined then?
F of x if f of x less than or equal to 2 and 1, 2 if f of x greater than 2.
Okay, good. Now let us draw a line, red line I will draw. Suppose here it is 2. Okay, if a function takes a value 2 here. Right now, this is the point at which f takes a value 2. Therefore, this is my f2 up to this part. And after this, f2. Right now? Therefore, red line is f2. Therefore, now f2 lies between 0 to 2. F1 lies between 0 to 1. Likewise, fn lies between
0 to n.
Here it is written. Check fn x less than or equals to n. Or I can write 0 less than or equals to fn, fn of x less than or equals to n. Right? Therefore, we have designed a new sequence of functions fn which are bounded now. Okay. And also increasing, can I say? Relation between f1 and f2. F2 is increased, no? F2 value.
Yes, ma'am.
This is fn is increasing sequence of bounded measurable functions such that fn converges to f. As we go, as you increase your value of n tending to infinity, may I say it converges to your original f? This is your original f, na? Green line. This is going to converge to your f1, f2, f3, so on. It will converge to original. Therefore, here one can write fn converges to f. Also, fn greater than or equal to 0. Therefore, by monotone convergence theorem. Now, monotone convergence theorem is true for increasing sequence of bounded measurable functions. Therefore, increasing sequence of functions. Therefore, may I use monotone convergence theorem to write integration f over e is limit and tends to infinity integration fn. Is it okay? Now, yes, the next part is easy. Now, the next part is very easy. Okay. Now, if this is so, may I write this in terms of epsilon notation? Mod of f integration fn minus f less than epsilon by 2 for all n in n. For every epsilon, there is an integer n. We have used this definition, no? Limit sequence xn tends to l. Mod of xn minus l less than epsilon for all n greater than or equals to capital N. This definition. Epsilon by 2 is purely an adjustment. How? Let us check. Now, this is integration f n minus integration f for all n greater than or equals to. Therefore, let me put the value of n as capital N. Therefore, what this statement will be? integration f capital N minus integration. Just now we have proved the result regarding difference, no? Integration f
yes,
minus g is integration. Therefore, here using the result, this is integration over e fn minus f. Still we are in the modulus, therefore can I change f minus fn? Now f is greater equal by fn. Therefore, f minus fn non-negative. Therefore, what about the integration? Integration is non-negative. And for the non-negative term, to keep the integration or not, next part I will write here. Therefore, to write the modulus or not is equal, no?
Yes, ma'am.
Therefore, may I write this is simply integration over e f minus fn. Okay. Thus, can I write this statement as integration f minus fn less than epsilon by 2 over e. Okay, now choose delta greater than 0 such that delta less than. Here it is an adjustment, we will check. Now we wanted to put integration f over a. Now I will write this a, first I will write this a f as f minus fn plus fn. Can I separate it as f minus fn over a plus integration fn? What is f integration f minus fn? Just now we have written less than epsilon by 2. This term is less than epsilon by 2. Now we wanted to adjust this term as less than epsilon by 2 again. Right? But integration fn is less than or equals to n we have written, no? There it is. What about integration f capital N? First term I am writing less than epsilon by 2. Second, can I write integration over A into capital N? Reason for this is fn is less than or equals to N. Okay. Now what about integration? Am I audible, students?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes.
N into major of A.
Yes, it is n into major of a. Now, how should I adjust the major of a, which is less than delta, so that this term I will get epsilon by 2. Major of a is less than delta. Delta less than which term should I write so that this will give me epsilon by 2?
Epsilon upon 2n.
Epsilon upon 2n.
Epsilon upon 2n. It's a pure adjustment. For here I just keep capital N into epsilon upon 2n, which gives you epsilon by 2 plus epsilon by 2, which is epsilon. Hence we have proved integration over A of f is less than epsilon. Means for every epsilon, we can find out a subset A of the set E such that major of A is less than delta and integration f over A is less than epsilon. We were going to use this preposition in order to prove the next part of the proof. Any difficulty in today's lecture?
No, ma'am.
What? Let us stop for today then. Thank you for being with me for this lecture. If you have any difficulty, you can ask. This is what nicely I am trying to explain you how those functions work. F1, F2. Whenever you define any function, no? You try to put it on a graph so that the idea will be clear. Okay. Okay. It seems there are no difficulties. Shall I stop? Thank you for being with me for this lecture.